Assalamu alaikum. Dear students, last time we discussed about the malignant and the benign tumors. Now today we are going to discuss the pre-malignant problems of the uterus and the cervix. The most important in the uterus is endometrial hyperplasia. What is endometrial hyperplasia? Endometrial hyperplasia is actually increase in the number or the numbers of the cells lining the endometrium and increase in the thickness of the endometrial layer. So hyperplasia, as we all know, that the thickness of the endometrium is it varies, and it varies in the reproductive age group and in the postmenopausal age group. In the postmenopausal age group, the thickness of the endometrium should not be more than 5 millimeters, but in the reproductive age group, the thickness of the endometrium can vary according to the period of the menstrual cycle it is taken, and this is taken by the help of an ultrasound measurement. So in the reproductive age group, the maximum height of the endometrium which should be present and should not be more than this is 12 millimeters. So we divide endometrial hyperplasia. If the cellular layer is thickened, or the ultrasound report says it's a thick endometrium, then we must measure, and then we classify it into three types. One is the simple hyperplasia, the other one is the complex hyperplasia, and the third one is the atypical hyperplasia. Now in simple hyperplasia, what happens? There is only the glands are increased in size, they increase in number, and the stroma is there, but is still abundant as compared to the number of glands present. And there is no mitotic figures, there is no ATPS seen. Whereas in complex hyperplasia, the glands are more densely populated, they are more densely placed with irregular outlines, and there is formation of outpocketing of the glands and the infoldings of the lumen of the glands. The stroma is present but is scanty as compared to that seen in simple hyperplasia. There are no atypical figures present. In the third variety, which is called complex hyperplasia with atypia, this is identified by nuclear enlargement. That is, the nucleus is enlarged, it is rounded and is irregular, and the placement of chromatin is such that it appears darkly stained. So the nuclear to cytoplasmic ratio, that is also disturbed. This condition is known as the carcinoma in situ, and it can progress to invasive carcinoma if it extends beyond the cellular outlines, if it extends beyond the margins of the epithelium. So this is a pre-malignant condition, if severe enough, can lead to invasive carcinoma. In this diagram, you will appreciate that this is a cut section of the uterus which has been shown, and this is the hyperplastic endometrium which is visible as thick layer. See, this one is even more severe. This is the histology of that part of the endometrium which has been taken. The glands are increased in number, the stroma is less, but still it's present to a moderate extent. But in this case, you see the hyperplasia is more intense, the glands are increased, and the stroma is relatively scanty as compared to the previous this one diagram. Why it develops? It develops in the presence of continuous estrogen stimulation, which has not been opposed by progesterone. Okay, so we all know endometrial hyperplasia is a non-cancerous or non-malignant condition, and it can occur in any part of the endometrium, and is most commonly it occurs before menopause and after menopause. In that case, it can progress to endometrial carcinoma as well, because normally it should not be there in a postmenopausal woman, because the estrogen which is present as a reproductive hormone in the reproductive years is not there in the postmenopausal woman. Now, what are the risk factors? Number one is the unopposed estrogen stimulation. Number two is nulliparity. That is, if a patient has not given birth to any baby, she has never been pregnant. So what happens, she is having regular cycles and they are present, and they in pregnancy there is predominance of progesterone, which nullifies the effects of estrogen. So if that case is not there, then patient is at risk for developing endometrial carcinomas. Delayed menopause. Those patients who have early menarche and the menopause at a delayed age group, the uterus is exposed to more frequent cycles. So these are the patients who are at risk. Similarly, in polycystic ovarian syndrome, what happens? There are anovulatory cycles. Anovulatory cycles means there is predominance of estrogen. So these are exposed to, they can develop endometrial hyperplasia and later on frank malignancy. Obesity itself, because the estrogen is stored in the fat cells. So the endometrium can be exposed to this increased amount of estrogen which is present in the fat cells. Diabetes, hypertension, previous radiation therapy, and family history and tamoxifen therapy. Tamoxifen therapy, which is given to the patients with breast carcinoma, it works as an anti-estrogen on the breast, but on the uterus it acts like estrogen. The effects are similar to those of estrogen. These were the risk factors. Now, what are the protective factors? Multiparity, number one. A patient who has given birth to multiple babies and she has undergone the process of pregnancy multiple times, she has a protective effect of all this on the endometrium. If the patient is of average normal weight, she is protective. Combined oral contraceptive pills, because it controls the cycles. The estrogen and progesterone, they are given in equal amounts and the patient is protective. Progesterone therapy alone is protective. Menopause, less than 49 years of age. Menopause normally occurs at the age of 50 plus minus 1 year. So if it occurs less than 49 years of age, the patient is protective for the development of endometrial hyperplasia or endometrial carcinoma. Now the most common, what is the clinical presentation? The most common clinical presentation of patients with endometrial hyperplasia is abnormal uterine bleeding. It can be in the form of menorrhagia, metrorrhagia, or postmenopausal bleeding. Number two, the patients are more prone to develop vaginal discharge because of the increased activity of the glands which are present, as the number of glands has increased. The patient can develop neuroabdominal pain because, as the menstrual cycles are heavy because of this hyperplasia, the patients, they do develop low abdominal pain or dysmenorrhea at the time of menstruation. Now the investigations which should be carried out for such patients, these are vaginal ultrasound, number one. Transvaginal ultrasound will give us a better picture of the lining of the endometrium, and the thickness of the endometrium can be appreciated with the help of TVS. Endometrial biopsy or sampling with the help of PIPEL. Nowadays, this is an outdoor sampling which is available, and the patient can be sampled without general anesthesia. Then traditional dilatation and curettage, in which we want to take the curettings from the different walls of the uterus and the endometrium. So that is another factor. Then hysteroscopically directed biopsies can be taken from those particular focal points which look hyperplastic on hysteroscopic examination, and so that is called hysteroscopically directed biopsy. This can be carried out in those patients who are suspicious of having endometrial carcinoma at the same time, and the visual biopsy can be taken. How do we manage such patients? Now the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists gives us some guidelines. And these guidelines, they depend on different variables like the age of the patient, her desire for fertility future, and the symptoms which are present. Secondly, we must exclude any exogenous estrogen therapy. That is, if the postmenopausal woman is taking hormone replacement therapy in the form of estrogen, then that should be removed. And we must look for tumors which are hormone producing, like granulosa cell tumors. They can be present, they can be secreting estrogen, and that estrogen has a direct effect on the uterine lining. So either we have to, if tumors are present, we must remove them. If she's taking exogenous estrogen, that should be removed. And the treatment is continuous progesterone therapy for at least 3 to 6 months. Progesterone therapy, it relieves the patient of the simple of the these symptoms which are present and reverses the simple and complex hyperplasia, but not atypical hyperplasia. The dose for a premenopausal woman is 5 mg daily. For a perimenopausal woman, because the cycles have become anovulatory, close to the menopause, so that patient requires a heavier dose, and that is 10 mg. Similarly, in the postmenopausal woman, 20 mg is needed, and excuse me, if patient cannot tolerate this amount of progesterone, we can simply place Myrina, which is a hormone-laden device, intrauterine device, which can be placed in the uterus, and that causes atrophy of the lining of the uterus. Now we can re-biopsy if abnormal bleeding persists. As you look at this slide, there is a sign of danger. It means that hyperplasia with atypia is a dangerous symptom, is a dangerous effect, it's a dangerous problem. So if the patient has completed her family and she is not, she doesn't want any more future pregnancies, then hysterectomy is the best option. If the patient who wishes to have more children or who cannot tolerate surgery due to some reasons, then progesterone therapy can be given, but it's not absolutely. We have to keep an eye on the patient. The next topic which we are going to discuss today is the pre-malignant disease of the cervix. Now, similar to pre-malignant disease of the endometrium, there is a pre-malignant disease of the cervix, and this helps in the early diagnosis of cervical carcinomas. So, why do we want to have assessment of the pre-malignant disease? Because we want to understand the normal cervical epithelium. We want to define what is metaplasia and what is dysplasia and what is the difference between the two. And we must understand the concept of cervical screening. Cervical screening technique is the technique which is available, which can be carried out, and it can help in the diagnosis of cervical intraepithelial lesions, that is before it progresses to frank malignancy. Now, the first thing which we must know that benign diseases of the cervix, they are common, and they are usually asymptomatic. Or if they produce any symptoms, they are very mild. So the cervical cancer is the second most common cancer in women. The lucky thing about cervical cancer is that it is preceded by a pre-malignant form which occurs years before its invasion. So the malignancy can be diagnosed before it becomes invasive, and it can be diagnosed years before it becomes invasive. There is a definite screening which is available for the pre-malignant disease of the cervix. Now, if you look at this diagram, we know that the lining of the uterus is the columnar epithelium, whereas the lining of the vagina is the squamous epithelium. The point where these two epitheliums meet, this is known as the squamocolumnar junction. Now, in the childhood, the squamocolumnar junction is just inside the cervix. It's inside the canal. Whereas in the reproductive age group, as this is exposed to different, the estrogen which is present, which is secreted during the reproductive years, the endometrium, the cervical epithelium, and the columnar epithelium, they are present at some point just at the out pocketing of the cervix. Similarly, in the postmenopausal age group, since the patient has already been exposed to estrogen and to the environment of the vaginal canal, the cervical epithelium is then covered by the vaginal epithelium, which is the squamous epithelium, and therefore the squamocolumnar junction lies within the canal of the cervix. So this part, which is the original squamocolumnar junction and which is the present squamocolumnar junction, this is the area which is under wear and tear most of the time, and carcinoma of the cervix usually develops in this part of the cervix. This is called the transformation zone, which is the area of cervix between the old and the new squamocolumnar junction, and it is the area of risk of developing pre-malignant and malignant disease of the cervix. Now, among the benign diseases of the cervix, we all know that the columnar epithelium, it contains glands, whereas the squamous epithelium does not contain any gland, whereas when this squamous epithelium, it covers the columnar epithelium, the glands which are present, they secrete some mucus, and that results in the formation of follicles which contain mucus. These are known as the Nemothian follicles. They can be cervical ectropion, which was previously called cervical erosion, and then genital warts, they can also be present. Cervical ectropion or erosion is the physiological presence of columnar epithelium on the ectocervix. This increases in pregnancy and in the patients taking oral contraceptive pills. It may lead to vaginal discharge and postcoital bleeding. The management only includes reassurance and exclude other causes, and if distressing, area can be coagulated. Now, if we consider the pre-malignant disease of the cervix, there is a normal cervix. The human papilloma virus, it has been said that this is a causative agent for the development of cervical cancer. So the very first stage of the development of cervical cancer is the human papilloma virus infection. This can lead to cervical intraepithelial neoplasia grade 1, CNN2, and that progresses to CNN3, and that can further progress to cervical cancer. Human papilloma virus is actually a DNA virus, and about 100 different serotypes are available. And it commonly affects the epithelial surfaces, especially the epithelial surface of the cervix is very favorite for this virus. It has got two groups. The low risk type is the human papilloma virus 6 and 11. This generally causes genital warts, whereas the high risk groups are HPV 16 and 18, and the other subtypes 31, 33, 45, 56, all these serotypes can cause cervical cancer. And it is very common that many patients, they develop human papilloma virus infection. Now, what are the risks which increase the risk of transmission of infection? These are smoking, increased parity, early age of intercourse, oral contraceptive pills, and decreased immunity of the patient. All these things can result in the transmission of human papilloma virus infection to the patient. Now, if we discuss the classification, okay, now first we will see what is metaplasia and what is dysplasia and what is the difference. Now, metaplasia is just change of epithelium from one cell lining, that is columnar, to another, which is squamous. Whereas dysplasia is abnormal epithelial cells that fail to maturate. Like the patient develops hyperchromasia, large size nuclei, and there are increasing number of mitotic figures. There's increased nucleus to cytoplasmic ratio. The cytoplasm is scanty, and further, this is classified as mild, moderate, or severe. Now, this diagram will tell you and what is the normal epithelium of the cervix and how does it progress to invasive cancer. See, this is normal entirely, and this one is CIN1, that is some of the area they contain the nuclear and the cytoplasmic changes. CIN1 is mild dysplasia. This is in the dysplasia classification. There are three classification systems basically. There is a CIN1 classification, the dysplasia classification, and there is a Bethesda classification, which we will discuss later on. So in these two classification systems, CIN1 is also called mild dysplasia. See, the abnormal cells are present only in the lower third of the epithelial thickness. In CIN2, which is called moderate dysplasia, the epithelial cells, they are increased in number. And in severe dysplasia or CIN3, the entire thickness of the epithelium mostly is, it has got all these abnormal cells. And in invasive carcinomas, invasive cancer, these cells, they breach the continuity of the epithelium and they can spread to the submucosal areas and other tissues. So what can be the outcome of CIN1 or any type of CIN? Either it can regress spontaneously, or it can progress to a further severe form, that is from one stage to the other, but this takes years to develop. The third category is that it can progress to frank invasive carcinoma. So it is the detection and treatment of CIN itself, that is cervical intraepithelial neoplasia, which prevents the cancer of the cervix. Now, how should the screening be carried out? Screening for dyscariosis is done by obtaining cervical cytology, which is also called pap smear in the common language. And this cervical screening should be carried out every 3 to 5 years in all sexually active women from 20 to 60 years of age. There is a 10% to 15% chance of false positive, false negative result, but still this screening is very helpful. Now, these are the different management strategies for cytology results. If it turns out to be inflammatory, we have to treat the infection and repeat in 3 to 5 years as a routine. If it turns out to be mild dysgariosis, we have to repeat in 3 months, or then we have to repeat after 1 year, then as a routine. If still present, then colposcopy should be done if there are 3 borderline smears. Similarly, for severe dysgariosis, we must proceed to colposcopic examination of the cervix and then repeat after treatment. So if the invasion is suspected, then the management should be urgent colposcopy. Now, what is colposcopy? It is the inspection of the cervix with a low powered microscope. Okay, it magnifies the cervix 4 to 20 times. Now, what we see with the help of a colposcope is the abnormal vascular structures, the spunctation of appearance of the vessels, and the mosaic pattern of the vessel seen. We can apply acetic acid, and the degree of staining correlates with the severity of the lesion. Then there is a Schiller's test. That is, application of Liouville's iodine stains the normal cervix brown, and that gives the clinical diagnosis, with the help of which we can take biopsies from the abnormal areas. Sorry. Management of abnormal colposcopies. There are different techniques available. There are excisional techniques, and then there are ablative techniques. For CIN2, 3, and sometimes 1, the technique can be excisional, which is a large loop excision of the transformation zone. There can be laser cone biopsy, knife cone biopsy, or hysterectomy specimen. The ablative techniques include electrodiathermy, cold coagulation, cryocautery, etc., etc. And all these things, they carry a 90 95% curate. Adenosquamous carcinoma is less common than squamous epithelial intraepithelial neoplasia. It has the same risk factors, but it cannot be reliably screened by colposcopy. So this is again divided into high-grade and low-grade lesions, and is characterized by scalp lesions. Treatment is by large cone biopsy. There are different vaccines available for human papilloma virus now. These are the bivalent vaccine, which cover 16 and 18, and then there are quadrivalent vaccines, which cover 6, 11, and 16 and 18. They are available in the globally in different countries. So they are usually given to the girls at the age of 13 years, that is before they get married and before they enter up into any sexual relationship, that this vaccine is given. Thank you. I think we'll discuss it at some other time, and I'll give you questions so that we can have a thorough knowledge of the subject as a class. Thank you.